Welcome. Today we are going to be looking briefly on what we've learned so far for this term.
I want you to
pay close attention and also try to get your textbook revised and then go through some of the content on the previous pages or topics, alright? So that you can be effective in your examination performance. We actually started the term by looking at sound. Is it not? Yes, we say sound occur when an object vibrates. Is it not? You say a vibration is an upward or downward movement. Okay? And then we talked about how we hear sound. Robot boy, remember, I carried out this practical. Put a clock, a ticking clock inside the glass jar and slowly pumped out all the air. They could not hear the clock ticking again. And then we say when the material such as the clock is in an area where there is no air entering it, there is no air inside the clock, the glass jar, and there is no air entering inside the glass jar, we say such a place is called a vacuum. Okay? So in other words, Robert Boy placed a clock in a vacuum glass jar. And then he could not hear the clock ticking. This made him to conclude that sound are carried by what? Air to our ear. Then we also said that when sound travel in mediums such as air, water or steel, such sound is called sound waves, is it not? And then we concluded that what Robert Boyle actually saying is that we hear sound because sound waves come to our ear. So we look at examples of a sound instrument as well. Talked about the drum set, talked about your alarm clock, talked about your wall clock, then talked about your speaker, even humans will make sound. I also talked about your door, your bell. Is it not? Yes. And then we also say that sound travels in air, water and steel. Sound travel fastest in steel and sound travels slowest in air. Is it not? Yes. Now, we also said that we can measure sound by using a sound instrument which we call the sound level meter. Is it not? And we say we measure in a unit which we call what? The decibel, written as dB. Okay? Which is a special unit of sound. I remember I gave you some decibels of sound. I would say when everywhere is silent, the sound level meter will be reading 0 decibel. Is it not? I also said that when sound is above 120, it is considered as what? A noise. Is it not? Yes. Remember. And then we also said that sound travel in air, steel, and water. And then we say travel fastest in steel and slowest in air. Is it not? Yes. I don't know if you still remember. You can see the value there. Okay. Steel is 3600 meters per second. Water is 1430, while air is 330 meter per second. So this means that sound travel fastest in solid, steel and slowest in air. Okay. And then we move from there. We talked about materials that do not allow sound to pass through them. And we say they are what? Soundproof. We now talk about the importance of soundproof. Say soundproof help to reduce noise pollution. Soundproof protect our ears from loud noise, is it not? And say soundproof also help us to record music in music studio without making a noise. From there, we now move to musical instrument. Okay, we talk about an orchestra as a band which is made up of several instruments that produce music. Okay, if you remember, then we say orchestra is large instrument. Example typically of classical music, all right, which combines the instrument from different families. And then we also talked about these families of instrument, the string instrument like your violin, your cello, your viola. And then we talk about brass instruments such as your horn, your trumpet, your trombone, your tuba. And then we talk about wind or woodwind instrument such as your flute, your oboe, your clarinet, and then your basson. And finally, we look at percussion instruments, which include your timpani, your bass drum, your triangle, snare drum, and the cymbals. We also move from there, and then we talked about volume of a sound. We say volume is the loudness or softness of a sound, is it not? And then we now look at the highness or lowness of a sound as the pitch of a sound. So we say a pitch is how high or low sound can be. Then it depends on the instrument. For example, we say a siren is will give a high pitch sound, and then we say the roar of a thunder will give a low pitch sound, meaning that the faster the sound and shorter the sound, the length of the instrument, the higher the pitch. So faster sound and shorter length gives us high pitch, while slower sound and longer length gives us low pitch. Okay, I will say in music, a note is a symbol. That symbol I use, that it look like a signature that we draw on the lines of music. Okay, we say a note is a symbol showing the musical sound. Note can represent the pitch, so we say we use that note to represent the pitch. And then we say a high note gives a high pitch, a low note gives a low pitch. Okay, we say notes are building blocks of music. Okay, and then from there we talk about pitch of a sound. We say can be changed, say changing the pitch. So we can change the pitch of a sound by changing the what, the length. We now talked about a guitar, using the guitar for example. Do we now ask whether do we go and cut the length of the guitar? We say no. We say we do that by adjusting our fingers, is it not? Yes. And you remember that video you watched? From there we now move to a circuit. We say the circuit is a part through which electricity can flow. Alright? And then we say circuits need to be complete in order for lamps to light up. Do you remember? Yes, I believe you remember, because you actually build your own circuit, is it not? So look at an open circuit and a closed circuit. We said a circuit, when it is closed, the bulb will light up. When it is open, the bulb will disconnect. Okay? So close, light up. Right? Open, off. Are you seeing it? So a complete circuit means that the components are all placed in the correct way and that the circuit is closed. Remember, I also talk about the components we used to build the circuit. I believe, remember, say we need a switch, we need a bulb holder, we need your battery, you need your wire, and then you need your lamp, okay? And then we connected all this together to give us our complete circuit. And then we went on to say that the flow of electricity through a circuit is known as what? Electric current. We now talked about electric current. We say we cannot see electric current, but we can use model to represent it. We now use this model to represent it. We said you, the person standing now, is like the wire, okay? Why, or the conductor. Why the symbols you see with the arrow, they are the current and they are passing through you now. You will not move, but the current will pass through you. Okay, that's how we explain it. So when I say that the circuit is a loop, what it means is that current keeps flowing. When we say the circuit is a loop, we mean that current flows from the battery through the wire to the bulb and then back again to the battery. It's a continuous loop. That is, if you do not break it by putting off the switch, it will continue to flow until it uses up all the energy. Okay, so we now say that this means that the current flows from the battery around the circuit and back to the battery, and then the battery acts like a pump to push electrons around the circuit. Remember, I will say electrons are used to represent what? Current, is it not? Yes. Now also talk about why some of our circuits will not work. Okay, we say that when we connect our circuit, there are reasons why it will not work. One of those reasons, or some of those reasons, we say if the connection is not complete, okay, maybe we did not connect the battery properly, maybe we did not connect the wires properly, it will not light up. And then we also say that when the wires are broken somewhere, maybe there is wire is cut and you don't know, it will still not light up. And then we say, when your bulb is used up, so if your bulb is used up, or if you have a faulty component, okay, your lamp will not light up. Concluded by saying that electrical device will not work if there's a break anywhere in the circuit. And they will say switches are used to break a circuit on purpose. I remember I also talk about the fuse. We say the fuse is like a circuit breaker that helps to save our electrical appliances. Because if a high voltage is coming, the fuse wire will burn, okay, and then it will not destroy the device. All we need to do is to replace the fuse. I don't know if you still remember. We now move from there, and then we now started talking about a magnet, is it not? We say you have probably seen a magnet before. Then I'll give you an example of magnet, where we can find magnet in a compass, find magnet in your fridge, you find toileters, and then you have your chaise board. Now we said some of these magnets are made by magnetic powder. How do we make magnetic powder? We grind magnetic materials such as lodestones, okay, and mix it with the raw plastic rubber to make a plastic magnet. And then we talked about, say, magnets come in different shapes. I said the most common shape used in schools are bar magnet and U-shaped magnet. Okay, but we have three that we talked about. So we have the U, the bar, and then the circular or the ring magnet. Okay, so we now conclude by saying that a magnet usually has two poles, the north pole and the south pole. And then I also explained to you why we have the north pole and the south pole. We say because we are using the north pole and the south pole because scientists have discovered that the earth as a whole has what we call a magnetic field, which is called a magnetic force. That is, it behaves like a magnet also. Why? Because the inner part of the earth, which we cannot go into, is made up of ions, and ions have magnets. Okay, so because of this magnetic force on the ion, we have the earth aligning in that direction. So we will owe a magnetic compass, for example, because the earth is now pointing north-south. The magnetic compass will now be attracted to the south pole. That's why it's always pointing to the north pole, your magnetic compass. A compass is an instrument we use to locate a direction or follow direction. So we now concluded that experimentally, opposite or unlike poles of a magnet will attract each other. That is, if I take a north pole and a south pole together, they will attract each other. I illustrated it for you, remember, with a picture and also a video. And then I say if I take a north pole and a south pole, or a south pole and a north pole, they will attract each other. And then I say like poles or the same pole repair each other, that is, it will push each other away. Okay, so we have a pushing force and a pulling force. A pulling force is when the poles are opposite, north pole, south pole. We have a pulling force, it will pull the other one closer to itself, and then they will attract each other. Then we have a pushing force, south pole, or north pole, okay? It will repel or push the other one away. You saw it on that video, right? Yes. I will say, we now move on from there, saying there are some materials that, or some metals, not all metals are attracted to magnets, okay? So metals are attracted by magnet are classified as magnetic and non-magnetic, or metals rather. Then we say the materials that are attracted to a magnet are known as what, magnetic materials, while those that are not are known as non-magnetic materials. And then we now look at the important magnetic material. We say we have magnetic, iron, steel, nickel, and cobalt. I take it again: iron, steel, nickel, and cobalt. We say are all attracted to magnet, but we also remind you that although they are attracted to magnet, iron is not a magnet on its own, steel is not a magnet on its own, nickel is not a magnet on its own, cobalt is not a magnet on its own, but they are all attracted to magnet. Among all of them, iron has more powerful magnetic attraction than the rest. Okay, although steel is made up of iron and carbon and other constituent or substance, right? And then we'll now look at some of the magnetic materials and non-magnetic materials. We talk about bottle opener. We say bottle opener. We talked about bottle opener. We say is magnetic. Needle magnetic. Glass non-magnetic. Wood non-magnetic. Scissors magnetic. Button non-magnetic. Paper clip magnetic. Leaf non-magnetic. Plastic. A robot. A wooden table. Wooden table. Non-magnetic. Screw magnetic. Eraser. Non-magnetic, not magnetic. We now move from there. We now talk about aluminium. We say aluminium is non-magnetic metal that is light. It is easy to shape and it is what rust-proof. That is does not rust. Okay, just like the way your zinc will rust, another iron will rust. Aluminium does not rust. We now say that many cans that we use for drinking. Mineral and everything like your can mod, they are made from aluminium. Why? Because it does not rust. And since it does not rust, it cannot give us cancer. Okay, and it is quite expensive. We now say that it's quite expensive for us to produce aluminium from its raw material. I told you the raw material of aluminium is bauxite. Do you remember? Yes, I believe you remember. I said that we cannot easily produce it because it requires very high energy. The energy required to produce aluminium from bauxite is twice, even more than two times the amount you will need to recycle aluminium. So people decide to go into recycling of aluminium instead of producing new aluminium. We now say that recycling aluminium is better because it will also reduce pollution and it will also give job to people. Is it not? Yes, it will give more job to people. And then we now talked about how we recycle aluminium. We say we take it to a factory, and then from the factory we pass it through bar magnets. I didn't put that picture here, but you have it in your last lecture, is it not? Yes. And then we allow the materials to pass through the two bar magnets. All the ions will be attracted to the two bar magnets, leaving the aluminium. The aluminium will now pass through, will now melt the aluminium. Mold it to block, sell it to companies, or we melt it again and use it to reform a new can. Is that not? Yes. So we concluded that one important use of magnet is for the production of what? Aluminium. That now brings us to the end of this revision class. I want you to take time, go through some of your lessons, either through your textbook or through the internet. Go to your pages. Those ones you don't remember, practice your assignment, check your workbook, so that you can be very, very effective in this exam. It's your last exam, okay? And it's very, very important. Okay, why? Before the exam, make a card. Wish you success.